I want to welcome everyone to our very first Big Rock on the Map series event. You did not have to clap for me putting my glasses on. I do it almost every day. I'm Werner Trishman, an instructor here in the Fine Arts and Humanities Department at Pulaski Tech. I'm also, for lack of better words, the head poobah for the Big Rock on the Map series. The poobah. Before I introduce our speaker tonight, I'd like to take a few moments to provide some background. The Big Rock on the Map series is a continuation and expansion of the Big Rock Reading Series, which for several years has brought a series of terrific writers to Pulaski Tech. And as the Fine Arts and Humanities Department was planning to move into this fabulous new building, it seemed logical to remake the Reading Series so that it would, one, be a better fit for these facilities, and two, reflect a broader vision. The result is our new Big Rock on the Map series will aim to bring in not just noted authors, but worthy figures in other fields, theater artists, visual artists, filmmakers, musicians, and more. The hope is that this new expansion will more accurately showcase the variety of disciplines found in the Fine Arts and Humanities Department, as well as be a sharper mirror on the interests and pursuits of Pulaski Tech students. It was noted in the Tuesday's opening ceremony that this building is an incredible tool for Pulaski Tech, and indeed it is. The Big Rock on the Map series will aim to match that value and be a significant resource not only for this college, but for the community as well. I want to take a moment to acknowledge those who helped make this series possible. The first person I need to mention is Joey Cole, who is the Dean of Fine Arts and Humanities. He's also known as what he is, which he's some sort of tireless, non-human automaton who provides almost constant inspiration, support, and wisdom. And we thank Joey for his support for this series. I also want to thank the Pulaski Tech College Foundation and essential help for tonight's event. Marsha Hines, I really have to single her out. She's just done such great effort in promoting this event, and I really want to thank her for that. Of course, I also need to thank the Pulaski Tech administration and Dr. Margaret Ellerby for her great stewardship for this college in this new phase as we walk into this building. Inside your program, you're going to find a donor form for this series. If you enjoy tonight's event, even if you don't, and want to help us fund future events, you can turn in that tax-deductible donation form today or mail it to the address on the form. I did say tax-deductible. And at this time, I also need to recognize the Philip R. Johnson Family Foundation for their substantial gift to the Big Rock series. We thank them. In thinking about what person would be the best fit for this significant event for the Big Rock series, the first name that came to mind was Doug Blackmon. And it wasn't only because Doug happened to be the best man at my wedding. That was significant because I knew he wouldn't turn me down, but it wasn't the only reason. If you take a look at your program, you will see Doug's bio, and I want to just walk through a little bit of that because we are really honored to have Doug here, and for numerous reasons. As the bio states, Doug has written exclusively over the past 25 years about the American quandary of race, exploring the integration of schools during his childhood in the Mississippi Delta farm town, lost episodes of the civil rights movement, and the dilemma of how a contemporary society should grapple with a troubled past. Doug has worked as a journalist for the Arkansas Democrat, Before, it was the Arkansas Democrat Gazette, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and the Wall Street Journal. At the Journal, he was the Southeastern Bureau Chief and senior national correspondent. Some years ago, those of us who knew Doug started to hear about a research project that he was undertaking. And this project ended up, he would tell of his tales of wandering into tiny Alabama courthouses and be down in the basement researching records. And like many of us who have friends who work on books, we think, oh, that's great, and then think of something else, like dinner. But Doug's project was not just any other project. It turned into the book Slavery by Another Name, which was published in 2008 and then won the Pulitzer Prize in 2009. This book received enormous praise, as you might imagine, and the one that I want to single out was by the late Andrew Young, former aide to Dr. Martin Luther King and U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations. He said, "Doug Blackmon has exposed an awful truth about the continued abuse of power and continued post-slavery exploitation of the poor into the 20th century." In 2012, there was a Doug helmed the PBS documentary called Slavery by Another Name that was received 5 million views. And now Doug is the executive producer and host of American Forum, a 30-minute public affairs show broadcast and seen on more than 200 PBS stations every week. So, I would like to welcome to the stage Doug Blackmon.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Thanks for the overly kind introduction, Warner. We have a compact that there are certain things we don't talk about, but we can't acknowledge being in each other's weddings. It is really good to be here tonight. It's good to be back in Little Rock, a city where that I loved living in and working in now more than 25 years ago, I think. It's sort of scary to say that, but it's good to be back here. The kinds of people who come out to an event where I'm talking, I find, are also always people who are interested in at least what I think are the most important issues that face America today, the national issues that we often don't want to confront and that many of our fellow citizens shy away from. And so it's always good to be at a place like this and with people who care about these things. And I realize there may be some students in the room who were compelled to be here as well, but I'll accept that part of the crowd too. Also, I want to mention that my mom is here tonight, right in the center over there. She's come up from Monticello. She's a truly great lady, and won't be time to go into all these stories today, but a lot of the reasons that that I'm interested in some of the things that I am and some of the work that I'm doing now, in fact, has much to do with really brave decisions that she and other moderate Southern whites who were bewildered in the 1950s and 60s and 70s about what exactly to do about the way the world was changing. And so many of those people, their principles and their constitutions failed in the midst of those decisions, and it's a thankful thing for all of us that some, like my mom and my dad, did not. And so, thanks, Mom. But she has with her as well my niece, Grace, who's a student at Hendricks, somehow made the baffling decision after growing up in Washington State to come to Arkansas to go to college. So there you go, at my alma mater. So that's terrific. But it's great to have you both of you there. But then also, before we go any further, not to be too much old home week here, I just want to say how good it is to be able to do anything in support of anything that Warren Trishman is involved with. Warren and I, as he told you, have known each other for a long time, and I consider it one of the great accomplishments of my life, in spite of anything else that might be on my resume, that I produced and directed the first production of any play written by Warner Trishman when we were students at Hendricks College. And since that time, I have watched him as an artist and in his life show a kind of resilience around his artistry and a dedication to becoming a better and better writer, artist, and human being in a way that has astonished me. I mean, it turns out that the great artists that we know about, it's almost always mostly because they simply refused not to be heard. Almost all, there's so many people, myself included, who give up on being that kind of an artist very early in their lives. And Werner just refused to give up and continued to fill his work and his life with a well of human compassion and principles that have astounded me and inspired me. So thanks for all of that, Werner. But then why I'm really here tonight. I wrote this book that you've heard about, and I'm sure that one or two of you have not yet finished reading all the way to the end. And I will talk about that. But I want to put it in the context of something a little broader, perhaps, than this history. And this is the thing that I'm most interested in now, and the thing that my current writing and research is most focused on. And hopefully there'll be another book and another film that you'll be able to see sometime late next year or early the following year that gets into some of these things. But what I'm really interested in is what I consider to be the central paradox of American life. And that is, how could it happen that after 50 years in which, as a society, we have so successfully and effectively defeated individual racism, the kind of racism that what we meant when we said racist 50 years ago or even 30 years ago, the idea that a white guy like me was, that there was a high probability that a 50-year-old white man you met anywhere in the South was going to approach any African-American person with, at best, negative preconceived notions and more likely ill intent of some kind. That kind of racism, which we have largely wiped out of American society. Sometimes we don't want to admit that. Sometimes we want to dwell on the bad things and not really acknowledge that this astonishing sort of miracle has occurred in terms of how much society has changed in the way that we relate to each other individually. And yet at the same time, we've defeated that so effectively, but it's still the truth that the vast majority of white people in America don't really give a damn that there are so vastly more obstacles in the lives of almost every black child in America than there are for almost every white child in America. We live in this society in which that is filled with disparate treatment and filled with disparate obstacles for different kinds of people with no real explanation. And yet the vast majority of middle class white folks, as well intentioned as we are, ultimately don't really care about that. Don't want to be bothered about that. We didn't do anything to cause it, is the logic that we have, if we ever even think about it consciously. We're not doing bad things in our day-to-day lives, so it must not be our fault, and so it may be unfortunate, but it's not something we really should have to give a damn about. And to me, that's the ultimate paradox of American life. How did that happen? Why is that? After all the success, why are we in this place? And I think that has everything to do with why it is that in a country that has accomplished so much on race, so many of us live lives that have different kinds of people in them, so rich with the diversity of American life, how is it that that is still a society in which things like Ferguson and Baltimore and all the other things that have so traumatized the country over the last 2 years, how do those things continue to happen in a society that has made so much progress? That's the paradox that I really am interested in right now. And I think there are three answers to that. To that question. By the way, I've never offered this premise before that I'm offering to you tonight. And in fact, I spent some afternoon trying to figure out exactly what it was before I came here, and then I couldn't get my notes to print out. So I'm operating off a few things that I scratched down in letters too small to read without my glasses. So the notes are all but not here. But I think there are three reasons, three answers to that question. The first is history. And the first really is what my book is about. And that is that for 100 years after slavery, the great American sin, the cardinal American sin, you know, the stain on our society that is indelible, but for 100 years after what was supposed to have been the end of American slavery, of course, it did not end. And by that, and what my book's about, is not that African Americans faced a hard time after slavery. I don't mean by that that being called by a bad name, not being allowed to vote, being born into a almost certain state of poverty, being allowed to go to the same schools as white children, or not having schools at all for millions of African American children in many places for many decades. That's not what I mean. We all know those things happened. We know about segregation and about the terrible injustices of the Jim Crow South and the prejudices that were all across the country. What my book is about, and I'll talk more about it, but the history I'm really talking about is that slavery did not go away. Slavery was just interrupted by the Civil War. And there was a period of time that the formerly enslaved 4 million black Americans had a kind of real freedom, but it was very brief. And then a new kind of slavery came back, and millions of African Americans lived in a world in which hundreds of thousands were enslaved, and millions lived in fear that this could happen to them. It's really a history that is about, no matter what your understanding has been of what was happening in America at the beginning of the 20th century, no matter how sympathetic you are to the idea that African Americans were terribly mistreated, the reality is it was far, far worse than almost any of us can begin to imagine, black or white. It was far, far worse than what we have understood. And so that history is obviously a huge part of the answer to my question, that we have this terrible history that we have been unable to fully grapple with, fully comprehend, fully work through the consequences of. And that is a history which still powerfully shapes the world we live in today, and why some people have more wealth than other people, and why some families have achieved a status in society different from other families and other kinds of people. It's that history that is rooted in the idea that until the end of the 1960s, or it's really only at the end of the 1960s, that one can even begin to argue that African Americans have any kind of equal access to the mechanisms of achievement in American life, and all the ways in which white families lifted themselves out of poverty over the course of the 200 years before that. So that's the first part of the answer to my dilemma, and I'll come back to that. The second part is something that now is kind of a boring topic to a lot of us. Not to me, but to a lot of people. And that is the failure at the end of the 1960s and the beginning of the 1970s, after the great achievements of the Civil Rights Movement, the failure of our society, once again tested with what would turn out to be the most difficult part of the Civil Rights Movement. And that was the integration of public schools. Now, what we like to remember about the Civil Rights Movement and the things that we really focus on are the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964, in particular, and the Voting Rights Act in 1965. And it's true that those were unimaginably important achievements. But it's also true that by the time they happened, they proved to be far easier to manage. You know, our society accepted them almost immediately. I mean, if you go back to the news coverage around the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which was the year I was born, so I can only faintly remember reading the papers that year, but if you go back and reread them, there was tremendous concern about the act, that in fact much of the opposition to it in Congress was focused on how terrible, truly terrible it would be if white motel owners in the South were actually forced to allow black people to rent rooms from them. The public accommodations portion of the Civil Rights Act was considered to be the most explosive element of it. This idea that the government would force white people to have to be in a motel room next to a motel room with black people in it. There was tremendous concern about that. But then once the act passed and the public accommodation part went through, what happened? Well, white motel owners realized that the money from black folks was just as good as the money from white folks, and suddenly they became very good at renting their rooms to everybody. And so in the blink of an eye, it was not an issue at all. And that's not to oversimplify or overstate the ease with which the Civil Rights and the Voting Rights Act were passed, but in the end, these things which people had imagined would perhaps be insurmountable, these moralities that could not be legislated. No matter if we pass these laws, there's no way that white Americans or white Southerners will accept all this. But it turned out that they did. They were implemented relatively easily. But then by the time we got to the end of the 1960s, America was finally compelled by the Supreme Court, not so much by the Supreme Court decision, the Brown decision in 1954, which people in Little Rock have a real consciousness of, and the legendary story of Central High in 1957, and all that is the, we remember that that is when schools were integrated in America. But in reality, even what happened in Little Rock, and certainly what happened almost everywhere else in the ensuing decade, was fake integration. Tiny little samplings of integration. And the reality was, it's not until the very end of the 1960s that the Supreme Court issues another order in 1969 that finally forces schools all across America to be immediately, completely, fully desegregated. And what happened then? Almost all the white people took off. Wherever there were a lot of black folks, almost all the white people took off. And so the second part of the answer to my question about my dilemma is that moment in time. Because that was a moment when we had an opportunity as a society, through the public schools, at a time when almost 99% of all American children attended public schools. And so we had an opportunity in this one place where we could really begin to shape society in a different way, that we failed. Most white people who had the responsibility, not just the opportunity, to be a part of that, ran away. And in doing that, we failed to enlarge what has been, if there is anything that is true to the idea of American exceptionalism, if there is anything that's truly special about the American experience and American society that has been an ingredient of our success more than any other, it has been a sense of empathy among Americans for one another. It has been that over the course of our history, those frontier towns that were settled in the middle of the forest, or the colonists who landed in the very beginning, contrary to what you might hear, it was not simply rugged individualism that made those communities survive. It was a sense of empathy for one another, was the reason that these incredibly improbable experiments could in fact succeed. And so when people were out in these places and they decided it would be good for their community to have a school for all their children to go to, they banded together and they formed the first public schools. When they decided that they actually wanted to have paved streets, or that they wanted to have lights down the way, or that they wanted to have a telephone line, once those technologies came along, they banded together and they did those things in a sense of empathy and common purpose. But for hundreds of years, we did that only as white Americans for other white Americans. And that says it a little too broadly than the reality, but that's what it boiled down to. And so there at the end of the 1960s, we had an opportunity as a society to expand our sense of empathy as a nation and to finally include everyone. And we ran away from that in so many ways, but particularly around public schools. And so our failure there is the second part of the explanation. And then the third part is our system of justice. And the situation with our system of justice today is very closely related back to the history that I write about in Slavery by Another Name. And so I'll circle back to that as well. But what we have today, it's oftentimes for me difficult to call it a system of justice. And I say that with great admiration for some of the most remarkable people I know and even call friends of mine are ones who are very prominent in the system of justice, and they get frustrated with me when they hear me say these things. But I've not long ago, I was sitting with Attorney General Holder when he was still the Attorney General, and I said to him in front of a bunch of other people, and he actually is a friend of mine, and his wife's a particularly good friend of mine. But I said to him, I said, Attorney General Holder, you and President Obama have been talking about the problems of mass incarceration since when President Obama was first campaigning for office, all through his administration. Both of you have been talking about it. You're obviously sincere about it. And yet, this was a year and a half ago, and yet you've done nothing. In fact, you're the mass incarcerator in chief. You, Eric Holder. You know, when will something finally begin? And happily, some things have finally begun, I'm sure, just because I asked that question. But But what we have is not a system of justice, but a system of injustice, a designed system of injustice. And by that, what I mean is that our system of justice is one that is still rooted in its origins in the late 19th century and the ways that it evolved in the early 20th century at a time when it was designed to fail one specific group of people. It was designed to be a system of justice for white Americans and designed to be a system of injustice for black Americans. It was built to have different outcomes for different kinds of people. And in fact, I think our system of justice became so dangerously corrupted, even with people of completely pure intent operating it oftentimes, though God forbid when people of poor intent were operating it. But even when run by the very best Americans, it is a system that cannot help but have disparate outcomes for different kinds of people and people who look different. And frankly, I've reached a point that I think it probably cannot be reformed. I feel the same way about our system of justice that the Republicans feel about Obamacare. It needs to be pulled up out of the ground by the roots. Radical change. But whatever one thinks about how it could be changed or why it works badly, we know it works badly. And that as well, that's the other leg of this dilemma of how is it that we have achieved such success at eliminating or reducing personal racism, but we live in a society that continues to treat different kinds of people so differently and set them on paths destined for collision. So those are the components of it, but I'll talk a bit about slavery by another name and the first of those three things and the way it also relates to the world of justice that we have today, or the lack of justice that we have. But slavery by another name is the story of how, as I said before, slavery didn't end when it was supposed to. It tells how immediately after the Civil War, the Southern economy was devastated. Obviously, we all know that story. In fact, the entire American economy was devastated by the Civil War, in large part because it was so reliant on cotton grown in the South, even the North. Some people don't realize that while cotton was often talked about as being the biggest industry, the single most important industry in America, being the production of cotton until 1860. But there was one other industry in America that was even bigger, and that was the industry of slavery, because slavery was an industry. Slavery was not just a condition, it was a business enterprise. And the capital and the investments in enslaved people was greater even than what had been invested in the production of cotton. And what the business of slavery contributed to the national economy exceeded that of cotton. It was the single biggest economic activity in America. And the destruction of that and the destruction of the Southern cotton system left the country adrift. And so in the aftermath of the Civil War, for a combination of reasons, some of them economic, some of them political, some of them purely racist, the white Southerners who had relied most heavily, by the way, wonder is there any chance I could get a bottle of water? There it is. Okay, there we go. Thank you. Pardon the interruption. So in the aftermath of the Civil War, those people who had relied most heavily on slavery, and even more so, those people who had been experimenting, and it sounds a little obscene to talk about things involving human beings this way, but before the Civil War, there were industrialists and business people in the South who had begun to experiment with different kinds of slavery, with using enslaved people in industrial settings, something which had almost never been done before. Enslaved people almost exclusively worked on farms and as agricultural workers. But in the lead up to the Civil War, there had begun to be Southern business people who began to put enslaved people into factories and textile mills and new kinds of industry that were developing in the South. And that kind of slavery was significantly more ruthless, more terrifying, more mortal for the enslaved people who found themselves there, in part because the business of slavery had two sources of income, typically. One was what could be made from the labor of enslaved people, the obvious part. But the other revenue stream of slavery came from procreation. It came from breeding slaves. And in fact, there were people in the South, if you go back through the census records of 1850 and 1860, you'll find people who identified themselves as Negro breeders. They had there were farms to farm the creation of more enslaved people. And so, but procreation, children, were essential to the economy of slavery. And so an enslaved man would almost certainly always live in a place before the Civil War where there were enslaved women, because there was both the desire for enslaved people to live long lives so that full productivity could be stolen from them over a long period of time, but also because their children would be valuable and would contribute more labor. But in the last years before the Civil War, there began to be these experiments of a different kind of slavery, where there would be almost no women involved. Only men would be worked in a particular place, and they would be worked to the very edge of human existence. A level of productivity would be forced out of them that would have been unimaginable in the earlier days of slavery. And the idea was, and this was particularly the case in places like the Mississippi Delta, which was just beginning to be heavily, heavily farmed at the time. And there, out in this wilderness that was almost impossible to live in for most people, there were these plantations with huge numbers of enslaved men, almost no women there. And the theory was that if these men could be kept alive for at least 5 years, that was the goal. If they could survive in this environment, working to the very edge of human limitations for 5 years, then they could pay for themselves and give a return on the investment that had been made in acquiring them. And so the mortality of this new kind of industrial slavery grew higher and higher and higher. And so after the Civil War, there were a group of capitalists in the South who were... Pause. That's better. So after the Civil War, there were people who desperately wanted to resurrect this. They had made huge fortunes. They'd come to realize what a valuable economic enterprise this could be. And so in the aftermath of the Civil War, a certain group of people began to attempt the reconstruction of something as close to slavery as possible, but one that would be even more vicious and brutal than the slavery that had preceded the Civil War. And as soon as they began to do that, the way they were able to acquire human beings for this was through the criminal justice system. In the end, every southern state, in one way or another, adopted a system in which people who had been arrested and convicted of crimes were then made available to be leased out, though in the parlance of the time, they were sold. If you look at the contracts, they actually talked about buying and selling people. But all of the southern states began to sell their prisoners, make them available on the public market to be acquired, not for a lifetime, typically, but for long periods of time, and periods of time that oftentimes the enslaved people didn't survive. And so, in many respects, it became a return to a lifetime of slavery. It overwhelmingly involved men, though not exclusively. There were also women who were pulled into this, and there were some white people who were pulled into this kind of a system. But overwhelmingly, this was something which happened to African American men. And one of the most diabolical elements of it was that once this process started, it recreated the market, as you say on Wall Street. It recreated the market, it made the market for human beings again. It reestablished what the value of a man was in this situation, because you could go down to the courthouse, and what did it cost to acquire a black man from a judge or from a sheriff? And the judge or a sheriff might set that rate, or there might be a market rate of how much could they get for any particular person or any particular man. And once the market rate had been reestablished, and it was incredibly low, it was incredibly cheap to acquire a human being from the criminal justice system, maybe $4 or $5 a month, or $20 or $25 a year to acquire a human being. Of course, these were people who, before the Civil War, it had cost $1,000 or $2,000, a tremendous amount of money in that era to acquire a human being. And so high a value that before the Civil War, the owners of slaves, I don't really like those terms, I don't like the term slave, I don't like the term owner, but we're forced to use them. But the owners of slaves before the Civil War had every economic reason to protect at least to some degree, these human beings that they had spent all of this money to acquire. But in this new world that began to emerge after the Civil War, there was almost no value attached to these individuals. The person that cost $1,000 15 years before now cost $10. And so there was no reason whatsoever not to work them to death. Not to work them to the very edge and to the very end. There was no reason to hold back any level of brutality if that brutality would get more work from this person in the brief time that you had control of them. And so this incredibly vicious system metastasized. And as that began to happen, political figures in the South began to also see that this was a powerful weapon for terrorizing African Americans. And so again and again and again, African American men who emerged as leaders in their communities, people who insisted that no, they did have a right to vote or that they did have a right to some sort of equal access to the courts or to their civil rights, again and again and again, for some reason, those men came to be arrested and sold into this terrifying, terrifying system. And so it became an instrument of terrorization and oppression and pushing African Americans away from exercising their civil rights. And this system continued in increasingly terrifying ways through the first decades of the 20th century and did not begin to fully withdraw from the lives of Black Americans until the era of World War II. It also reached a zenith of sorts at the very beginning of the 20th century, when another terrible, difficult turn in our history was happening. And that was that in the aftermath of the Civil War, the first 30, 40 years after the Civil War, there was a real clear division in America between whites in the South and whites in the North. The folks who were related to the people who thankfully won the Civil War, and we should all be really thankful, and by the way, it's not heritage, it is hate, but that's another lecture. But the folks related to the folks who had won the Civil War had some sense that they needed to stick with the idea that the formerly enslaved people in the South ought to get to become citizens like they'd been promised. But by the time you get to the early part of the 20th century, whites in the North have given up on that too. The issue of what to do about the place of African Americans in American life had bedeviled American politics in the same way that today we're bedeviled by what do we do about the Middle East, or was the invasion of Iraq a good idea or a bad idea, and we just can't seem to move past this thing and it exhausts us and wears us out. Well, that's the way it was at the end of the 19th century around the role, the place for African Americans in American life. And by the time the 20th century started, white people everywhere were ready to just give up, move away from the whole topic. And so the idea prevalent in the North then became, let's just let the white Southerners handle it. Let's just leave this to them. That's where all the black people still were. 99% of African Americans still lived in the slave counties of the South in 1900. And so white Americans across the board decided to just walk away from this issue. And in fact, across the country, there was a new consensus among whites that the citizenship and equality of African Americans simply wasn't worth the strife that it had caused between them and their white cousins down South, because basically no white American, I really mean this, and not a single one, not a single white American in the beginning of the 20th century truly, authentically believed in the equality of whites and blacks. There were no white Americans who truly believed that black people and white people were equal to one another. There were many white people who thought that African Americans should not be abused in the way that they had been abused, but no one thought that there was actual equality between these two groups of people. And so it was fairly easy by then for the whites who had been friends of African Americans to abandon them. And it was at that moment that the most terrible things began to happen that led to this re-enslavement of so many people. And I'll tell you one anecdote of that. From July of 1903, a letter arrived at the White House addressed to the president, though inside it made reference to Teddy Roosevelt, who had become the president in 1901. But the letter was written by a woman named Carrie Kinsey, barely literate African-American woman who lived just outside of Bainbridge, Georgia. It's a two-page letter. There's no punctuation. There are no capitalized words anywhere in the letter. But in struggling against the illiteracy that surrounded her in the world that she lived in, she wrote this letter to the president and said, "Dear Mr. President," and then she recounted that her 14-year-old brother, whose name was James Robinson, had been stolen from her house a year before. He'd been kidnapped by someone, taken to a farm nearby, and was being held there as a slave, chained, worked, chained, lashed, starved at a plantation. We can tell from the contents of the letter, she knew exactly where he was. She had almost certainly been there. She'd probably seen him in this condition. She knew who had taken him away. She knew who had purchased him and enslaved him. And this was something that had happened not because of a criminal offense he had committed or been accused of. This was not a sentence from a judge. But it was because there had begun to be so many black men arrested for things they had not actually done and then be sold into this new slavery, that there then began to be a new private enterprise of slavery in which thugs wandered the back roads of the South and could kidnap black men and sell them into the same system of enslavement that had been created by the criminal justice system. And that's what had happened to James Robinson. She knew where he was, she knew who had him, and she had been to see every person of power or authority in her world. No one cared. Can you imagine that? Just put yourself in that position. I have a 15-year-old daughter, so I try to imagine her in this position. But a child you know or love, or who's your child, has been kidnapped for a year. And you know where that child is. You know who the kidnapper was. You know who has purchased your child. And no one will do anything about it. And you reach a point of desperation so great that the only thing you can think of to do is write a blind letter to the President of the United States. When I found that letter, as I was going through boxes and boxes of documents of the National Archives, it was the single most arresting document of all the things that I found in the course of the research for this book. But what is even more tragic than that one letter is that it sits in a folder at the National Archives, and right beside it is another folder with another letter that tells almost exactly the same story from a different person. And on the other side of that is another folder with the same story. And on both sides of those, there are more and more and more of them. And it fills the box, and it fills the next box, and the next box, and the next box. There are 30,000 pages of those letters at the National Archives today. 30,000. And they all tell stories like that one. And in the end, Kerry Kinsey's letter was received at the White House, forwarded over to the Attorney General's office, stamped with a serial number for tracking, filed away, and no other action occurred. A world had emerged in America in which the sale of a black man, even the seizure and sale of a black child, was not considered a crime and was not considered something that a white person should care about. And I'll wrap up, because the questions you have will be more interesting than me hearing myself talk about this even more. But this world had emerged that we still live in the remnants of. That's not to say that the same things are happening today. There are all sorts of terrible things that are happening today. But the degree to which African Americans, because of this and many other things, were deprived of the opportunity for families to do as my family did, as my mother's family did, we were able to emerge from a kind of desperate poverty 100 years ago. Our family lived in straits very similar, economic straits very similar to the family of Kerry Kinsey in the first decade of the 20th century. But there are reasons why a family like mine was able to emerge, and thousands and millions of similar families, white families, were able to make the same migration out of that status, and why the black families who lived in the same place too often were not able to. It's inextricably connected to all of this. And these are the reasons why there remains such a broad gulf today in the economic achievements and educational attainments of African Americans. These events shaped the world that we live in today and the problems that the problems that we struggle against. And our opportunity to have begun to reshape that society through public schools and the opportunity that we blew in the 1960s and the 1970s that we continue to blow today, and the fact that this perversion of the criminal justice system that gives us mass incarceration today, gives us a lack of confidence in our system among so many citizens, are all rooted in this terrible history and rooted in our unwillingness to confront these things in current times. So I'll leave it with that, except to say, you know, just yesterday there were numbers that came out from an organization that does research on the criminal justice system. And last year, there were 80 people who'd been convicted of homicide. There were 80 people in America exonerated last year, who were released from prison after having been convicted of homicides in the past. A total of almost 300 people who had been falsely convicted of various serious crimes were exonerated in 2015. And there have now been more than 300 people on death row. 300 people slated for execution have in the past decade been exonerated for those crimes that they had actually not committed. So we live in a world in which it is difficult to rely on the most basic systems of our democracy. And all that I talk about, all that I try to write about, is to stand in opposition to the idea that none of us should really give a damn about any of those things unless we've had some direct hand in that. And this is an election year. I won't say which candidate you should pay attention to, but these are things that matter, and think about them when you decide who our next president should be. I'll stop there, and hopefully we have time for some questions.
Okay, we now have some time for some questions. We should have some people with some microphones. They'll be able, if you want to raise your hand and you have a question. Also, before we get started, I want to remind everyone, copies of Doug's book are for sale out in the lobby in the box office. If you would like to pick up a copy after this, he's going to be out in the lobby and he will sign a copy for you. Okay, do we have questions?
Just a quick question. So, outside of your book, how many folks anywhere know about your 30,000 number that you quoted?
You mean just in terms of how, do people know that that's the case, or?
Well, do they know that those notes exist, that they exist in that quantity?
Well, I think that there's a growing awareness of that, and that's not solely because of my book, but though happily, I think that when I began looking into this, and the way that I did that, it grew out of an interest that I'd had. Basically, I was a reporter at the Wall Street Journal at the time, and I'd always been intrigued by the way that in the late 1990s, there were Holocaust survivors in Germany and elsewhere around the world who brought lawsuits against German corporations that were remnants of companies that had existed during the Holocaust and companies that had enslaved Jews during World War II and before World War II. And there were Holocaust survivors who filed lawsuits against these companies, some of which were barely connected to the companies that had done these terrible deeds. But these lawsuits were being filed, and it was raising this issue of 50 years after the fact, even though the peace treaties at the end of the war had said claims like this could not be brought in the future, nonetheless, people were bringing these claims and saying what happened was so terrible, there's a moral burden that we should have to be, these things, it should be, there must be a way to reopen these cases while these last Holocaust survivors are still alive, these former slave laborers. And I was just intrigued by the way that Germany was being forced to confront in a new way the role of business in these terrible events of the past, which was something that had really never happened in the U.S. The Civil Rights Movement was about the state. It was about making the state stop doing bad things to black people or precluding them from their civil rights. And so I started looking into this idea of, essentially I said, what would happen if we looked at American corporations through the same unforgiving lens that Germans were then being compelled to look at their own business history. And so I started doing that. And I found my way to a place in Alabama where a unit of U.S. Steel Corporation at the beginning of the 20th century, what was at the time, U.S. Steel was the biggest company in the world. It was the original modern corporation. And there was this place where coal mines owned by U.S. Steel were being worked by thousands of black laborers who were clearly not people who had been properly convicted of actual crimes. There was all sorts of evidence that these were enslaved men. And so I ended up writing a long story about that one place in Alabama. And then from there, I began to look more broadly into this. And what I discovered was that there were scholars and historians who had done research on it. I was by no means the first person to look at this. But almost always, you'd have someone who wrote a PhD dissertation or something else about it, and then they never wrote about it again. They would write about some one fragment of the story in a certain place. And then later, I went back to some of those folks, and I would ask them about this. And invariably, they said, it just was so depressing. And there was so little interest in it from other historians. And also, because it led in the direction of a claim that most people are afraid to make a claim as broad as that slavery didn't actually end at the end of the Civil War. I was afraid to make that claim for a long time. But as I researched the book, which I did for 7 years, as I got deeper and deeper into it, I realized that that was the unavoidable conclusion. That was the clear preponderance of the evidence. And so there were other people who had looked at these documents, the National Archives. In fact, the person who came up with the 30,000 figure was not me. It was somebody else who did that calculation. So if it turns out that it's slightly larger or smaller, I'm absolved of blame for that. But a great historian named Pete Daniel was the first to write about that in a significant way. And so people knew it was there. People wrote about many dimensions of this in different ways. But in the end, most historians were dismissive or minimizing of all this, as was the case with most of the history written about most of the bad things done to black people for a long time. You know, it's only been in the last 30 years that in academia that there's been a forceful examination of these kinds of things. So I hope that's an answer, but yeah, I'm the good. I got a thumbs up. That was an answer.
Hi. I wanted to know how long did it take you to come up with all of this information?
Well, a total of about 8 years. That first story that appeared in the Wall Street Journal in 2001, I worked on for almost a year. Now, I did other things during that time, too, and I did other things in the next 7 years, like have children and all that, but the though they didn't see a lot of me at times, but in total I spent about 8 years in the research and writing of the book, because it was something that the further I went into it, the further it demanded that I go, and the, as Werner was saying in the introduction, you know, I was going out to these. At first, I didn't actually believe the story myself, even the things that it seemed to start telling me. I kept saying, it really isn't possible that it's what this begins to look like. It also was the case that when I would talk to most historians who had looked into this stuff at all, they typically would say something like, well, yes, something really bad happened. It's clear that it was something really bad happened. And it's clear that the criminal justice system of that time, that there were a lot of people who were being imprisoned or convicted for things that they didn't do. And it's clear that all the southern states were passing laws that were specifically designed to target black people. And what I mean by that is that it became a crime everywhere in the South to speak loudly in the company of a white woman. Now, that was a charge that was only ever brought against a black man. It was a crime in the South. In fact, the first gun control laws in America were passed by southern states specifically to limit the carrying of guns, and they supposedly would have applied to everyone, but only black men were ever charged with these violations of laws against carrying guns with you in public. It was a crime, obviously, for there to be sexual relations between black men and white women, or the other way around. But it was only black men who were ever prosecuted for miscegenation statutes, almost always only. In fact, it was almost always only black men who were charged with adultery, even which you know, even more so would have applied to white folks, I think we can be certain. But so there was a whole battery of laws, the most insidious of which was it became a crime in every southern state by the beginning of the 20th century. It was a crime both to be unemployed, as technically it's a crime to be unemployed today. You're a vagrant if you're unemployed. You run the risk of being a vagrant. But it was very much so a crime for any person to be unemployed. You could be arrested for being unemployed. If you couldn't prove employment at any time, only black men were ever arrested for being unemployed. But it was also a crime that if you had taken a job as a farm worker, and the vast majority of black men in that era in the South were farm workers, and the typical thing was that they would sign a contract with a white landowner to work on that farm for one season, for 1 year, and you would, this is before sharecropping even, but if in the course of that year, if you left the employment of the person you had signed up with without written permission from him, you were committing a crime. So it was and that was the case even if, and this, you know, all if you had taken a trip across the Mississippi Delta part of Arkansas, or across Mississippi, or across the Black Belt of Alabama, or across South Georgia. W.E. Du Bois did this and writes about it in one of the chapters in The Souls of Black Folk. But if you made a trip like that across the South in 1905, as he did, you would have seen black men chained together in the fields everywhere you went, being whipped by white overseers. Use of the lash at the beginning of the 20th century was endemic across the South. It would have been a scene hardly any changed from the scenes of enslavement that preceded the Civil War. And so if in 1925 you had signed a contract to work for a white man and you were being whipped in the field and being starved, being deprived of your wages, and your wife was being sexually exploited by the landowner, which was another uncomfortable but endemic reality in that era in the South. Even if all those things were happening, and some other white man came along and said, "Why don't you come work for me? I will treat you much better." If you took that job without permission, you were committing a crime in the South. And there were thousands and thousands and thousands of black men charged with that crime, breaking contract. And so, as I was pursuing this, and when I first began to see this, it was just difficult to believe that this could really be what it appeared to be. And I would ask historians about it, and they would say, yeah, definitely something bad was happening, and definitely there were people prosecuted for things that they probably hadn't done, and just for the purpose of selling them into labor somehow. There clearly was some of that, and there were some people at the time saying that that's what it was. There's record of that. But most historians would then say, but you know, we don't know for sure. You know, how do we figure that out? The records are all gone. You know, it'd be like trying to find a parking ticket from Chicago in 1942. You know, it's just impossible. The records just don't exist. There's no way for us to know. And I just couldn't believe that was true. And so, partly because I had been a police reporter for newspapers for so long, and I had learned that you know, the government creates a lot of documentation, even when it's doing bad things. And government workers are not very good about getting rid of documentation. It tends to pile up in boxes and places. And so that's why I started going from courthouse to courthouse to courthouse, all across Alabama, parts of Mississippi, parts of Florida and Georgia, just looking for these routine arrest records from those decades, the early 20th century. And of course, what I found were just millions and millions and millions, literally millions and millions and millions of entries that told this story over and over again. And it finally just became, the evidence was so insurmountable of what was actually happening. More than you asked for.
My question is, was there any research done with the descendants of the individuals that wrote those letters, those 30,000 some odd documents? Mr. Blackmon, we're so glad to have you here.
Is that my friend Donald Richardson?
Yes, it is.
My gosh, I'll be damned. Donald Richardson, who started the first grade with me in Lila, Mississippi in the fall of 1970, and the first class of children in Mississippi to go to begin the first day of first grade black and white together and go all 12 grades. That was the class of 1982. So I'm glad you're here, Don. And we haven't seen each other in 30 years or something, my God. In terms of the descendants. In fact, the epilogue of Slavery by Another Name is a series of dialogues between me and living people, some of whom are now dead. But the rest of the book is pure historical nonfiction. But that epilogue is a series of conversations, basically, between me and living people who were all descendants either of people who were so terribly abused or descendants of people who did the abusing. And most of whom had no idea that they were a part of that. And I'll pause to make a point that, in my view, you know, no person is responsible for what their grandparents did. We're all responsible for what we do. We're also responsible for how we respond to learning certain things. You know, we're responsible for whether we care what our grandparents did, but we're not responsible for what they did, or great-grandparents, or whatever. And so when I talk to people like that, I'm never trying to suggest that a person is tainted in some way because some ancestor did a terrible thing. But I did want to talk to those people. Because one, I wanted to know if they knew anything about it, and I did want to know what they felt about it once they learned about it. And in some cases, they did know some of these things, though almost always in this kind of crazy history where it had been twisted into a family story of which they were very proud. A little bit like the way that, I don't know if it's still this way, but it used to be if you went on the river road along the Mississippi River and started visiting antebellum mansions, you know, the tour guides would tell you over and over again how this building was built by slaves, and the bricks were made by slaves. It was all told with a great sense of pride. It was what was cool about the building was that slaves had built it, you know, and eventually, you know, you say, really, that's like saying this house was being built by Jews who had been seized from their homes in the 1930s. I mean, it's the idea that some moral, that the horror, the immoral horror of all this didn't attach to that history is one of the most terrible things about how we remember things. But so I went to great lengths, though, to find these descendants of both sides. And those, for me, that's the most powerful part of the book, are these dialogues. And I tried for years, in fact, I still find myself trying to find Carrie Kinsey and James Robinson. I never could find James Robinson, the boy who was kidnapped and sold into this plantation. And so he almost certainly died at that place. He definitely was not rescued. And so I have to assume that he died there. So many people died in the system, and part of what propelled me in the research was when I began to find in Alabama these mass burial fields, of which there are many. On the outskirts of Alabama, in this one place, there is this vast unmarked graveyard where the bodies of the men who were forced into those U.S. Steel coal mines were unceremoniously dumped over these years. And it's an almost impossible place to find and get to, but that's clearly what it is and what happened there. And so that's almost certainly what happened to James Robinson. I did, however, finally find, or he found me, a man who is almost certainly a sideways relative of Carrie Kinsey, who wrote that letter. His name's Bernard Kinsey. And Bernard has become one of my most cherished friends now. He's more the age of my mom, but he lives in L.A. His family fled Georgia, fled the area where Carrie Kinsey lived in 1903. But his family fled there just before he was born, obviously. But there was a terrible wave of lynchings and racial violence in that part of Georgia in 1916. And so his father and other members of their family abandoned Georgia. These stories are everywhere. everywhere in the history of African-American families. They fled that part of Georgia, ended up in Florida, and then his father had opened a little grocery store. They had some prosperity, and then Bernard was born in the 1940s, and then he went to FAMU. He married a fantastic woman who also at FAMU. They were in the band. He went on to Bernard then eventually became one of the first seven black employees at IBM, and those seven people, it's another great American story, how they then shepherded each other through their careers, and Bernard eventually became one of the highest ranking executives at IBM and then retired from there in the 1980s, a very wealthy man, ended up in Los Angeles. He co-chaired the Rebuild LA initiative after the Rodney King riots in 1992, the effort to rebuild South Central LA. And he was one of the key figures in all that. And so, and Bernard is in the film. The documentary was really taken over by the Descendants. Because I insisted to the director and some of the others involved that we had to do interviews with these Descendants. And the director, of course, was Sam Pollard, who's one of the great African-American documentary filmmakers alive today and one of the greatest human beings I know. And Sam will even say this, that initially he refused, or he just said, "Doug, why would we interview these Descendants? You know, what do they know about what happened in 1905? You know, that there's no reason." And typically in a documentary, you never would. And typically a historian wouldn't be interested in what the descendants of historical figures would say. But I insisted that we interview these people. And in the end, they took over the film. And it's really a film about them, about the descendants, and the descendants of the oppressors. And as the film goes along, even though they're never in the same shot, they begin to talk to each other, the descendants of those who were injured and those who did the victimizing. And so I have said to Bernard Kinsey that his whole life represents the loss that all of this is for all of our society, because James Robinson and this man who, you know, I like to stop on this picture. I don't know who that was. Don't know. He's never been able to identify his name. But you can see the shackles on his legs. He was a convict laborer working in those coal mines in Birmingham, Alabama, along with all of these other men. High probability that he was worked to death there at the same time as the main character in my book, a man named Green Cottenham. But these young men who were crushed by these events, well, every one of them might have been Bernard Kinsey. You know, Bernard Kinsey, this guy who lived a life of the most extraordinary achievement. And so that our society deprived ourselves of all of that talent and all of that humanity and all of that possibility, not just that we deprived ourselves of it, but we did it in a way that injured other people even more and set people apart. That's, in the end, that's the most terrible scale of the tragedy, is just how much we set back our society, how much white people injured themselves by doing all these terrible things, depriving our whole society of those lives. But so for me, that's one of the most powerful parts of it. So the epilogue of the book and the film. But I'm so glad you're here.
Sorry, let's get one more question.
The Kinsey collection will be at Mosaic Templars in March.
Oh, that's great.
Yes, and that's where I first met you.
Oh, but when I spoke there, though, that's terrific.
Yes. What,
and so just so I'll explain that very quickly, but Bernard Kinsey, who I was just describing, also he and his wife, Shirley, became collectors of African-American art and artifacts. And they own what is almost certainly the most important collection in the world of African-American art and historical artifacts that relate to the African-American experience. And now their collection travels around the country in a couple of different components and installed in different places for a long time. It's an exquisite gathering of art and historical objects. So I'm glad that it's coming to Little Rock.
Yes, at Mosaic Templars.
That's
so
great.
Go to their website. My question is, Hillary Clinton just lost my vote because she made a statement.
Actually, hold the microphone a little closer to your mouth.
Okay. Yeah. Hillary Clinton lost my vote. You got that, right? Because she said that open-minded, well-intended white people should be afraid of black men in hoodies. which reinforces the statement you made about negative perceived notions. Would you talk about that?
Well, sure. And when did Hillary say that today? Or I may have missed the...
It's all on Facebook, and I can't wait to get home to make responses to it.
Yeah, okay. I haven't seen that. But no matter what, or what she meant by that, I mean, I would also give Hillary the bet, and I think you should vote for whoever you want to vote for. I think that Hillary Clinton is one of those folks, and Bill Clinton is those are people whose heads ultimately are in the right place on these things. But she may well have said something that she would now regret. But regardless of the specifics of that, I certainly will say that one of the terrible problems we have as a society, one of the reasons why our system convicts so many people who are actually innocent, which, you know, it wasn't long ago that we didn't believe that was possible. That seemed very unlikely. If you think 25 or 30 years ago, the degree to which that we really thought that the 12-man jury always got it right, and that just somehow miraculously that we got it right more often than any other system in the world. I mean, that idea was so dominant in American thinking that we had the very best justice system in the world. Well, now we know. Now we know empirically that it messed up all the time. You know, that it was, even when it was not trying to do wrong, it was messing up all the time. And when it was trying to do wrong, it was absolutely diabolical. This does relate to what you're asking about. Circle back to, but all of these people who've been exonerated and released from death row, the most terrible thing about those stories is not the 300 people who've gotten off death row and what happened to them, but it's that those are just the cases where there was, thankfully, some DNA evidence. Almost all those cases were reversed on the basis of DNA that then was subjected to new technology and it proved that they were innocent. Well, the vast majority of people on death row were convicted in cases in which there is no DNA evidence. And so we know that just based on these exonerations that something like 5% of the time we falsely convict. Something like 4 or 5% of all the people who are convicted in our system actually are innocent. We now can statistically demonstrate that. But the percentage may well be much higher. And because we only use DNA in most of these cases, and the vast majority of cases there is no DNA. And so what that means is that there are many, 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 many more people waiting to be executed who are also innocent, and it also means that over the last 100 years we have executed almost certainly hundreds of people who did not commit the crimes that they were convicted of. And all kinds of other people have spent their entire lives in prison for crimes that they didn't do. And it is certainly the case that hundreds of thousands of black men have been imprisoned again and again and again for things they did not do. Or they have been imprisoned under circumstances that are vastly disproportionate to the events that occurred. But all of that has contributed to, and this is where I'm actually trying to answer your question, and this is a scientifically demonstrable thing now. Social scientists, you know, can demonstrate this, the degree of implicit bias that we walk around with. And it also applies to African Americans too. You know, that's one of the most terrible things in the studies is that you do careful studies with whites, African Americans, other ethnicities of people, and they all react negatively to images of a black man in a hoodie. You know, that these preconceived notions have become so deeply embedded in the society that we live in that even when people are actively trying to overcome these things, they are often guilty of this kind of implicit bias. It's partly a derivative of the kind of structural racism that we live with, but it also basically boils down to that we live in a society, and I love our society, and I love our country, and I love the values that we're built on. But we live in a society that was born in white supremacy. White supremacy is as basic an American ideal as freedom, or freedom of speech, or the right to go to whatever church you want to go to. White supremacy is just as fundamental a notion, because when this country was created, it was created based on that notion of white supremacy. In fact, I would even say as radical a thing as that white supremacy is so pervasive in our society that it is impossible for us not all to be infected with it in some way. It's not a question of whether you have this element of thinking somewhere in your mental DNA. The question is how you respond to it, how you deal with that this thing has been planted in you, because it is impossible to live in American society and not be at great risk of being infected by this notion somehow that one way or another, don't mean to be harmful about it, mean, but yeah, white people somehow do seem to just do better than everybody else, and so it must be that they are better somehow. That idea is endemic in the fabric of our thinking, and so it translates out into these kinds of implicit biases, and we should all, myself included, we have to be actively on guard. We have to presume that we're vulnerable to those sorts of presumptions, and we also can't say careless things like what Senator Clinton said, if indeed she did. So I better stop right there. Thank you all very, very much.
I want to thank everybody again for coming out tonight. I'm sure the administration, Pulaski Deck Foundation, would like me to remind you, if you don't already know, that Mayfis Staples will be here tomorrow night. What time? Let's say that again. Concert starts at 8:00, and the doors open at 6:00.
Yes, there's a cash bar.
And there's a cash bar. Thank you all for coming out tonight. If you would like to buy a copy of the book, there's some available in the lobby. Doug will also be out there to sign copies. Thank you again.